lost screen. There we go. Screen. So this session will be recorded, so others that can't get to this session tonight will be able to watch it. So I'm Yinka and I run Hear My Voice Book Club, which is an inspirational self-development books. They can all be found on Meetup. It's also, we've also got a Law of Attraction group with Abraham Hicks teachings in Manchester, Stockport. And there's also a Liverpool one that I also help run as well. Can be found on Instagram. Got email is yinka@hearmyvoicebookclub.com. So if there's any questions after this, you can email me. This is the type of stuff that we have on. What we've got left is tomorrow, we've got Friday's children's story time, which my son Malachi creates. So he'll be putting that on tomorrow at 7 p.m. Separate Zoom link for that. You have to message for that one. That's just to prevent Zoom trolls joining. Saturday, we've got Sean T's cardio workout. That'll be my last session until the 26th of February. I'm taking a full week off. Don't know what I'm going to do with myself, and the kids are going away. So that's it. So Saturday will be our last session until the 26th. Thursday, the 2nd of March, for those that love Don Miguel Ruiz, Don Josh Ruiz, his son, we're going to do The Wisdom of a Shaman, my favourite book. As March is my birthday month, I decided to choose my favourite book. So that'll be the Thursday, the 2nd of March. We have two times for the monthly book club, which is 10:30 a.m. or 8:30 p.m. We also have in-person events, which is the 8th of March. If you live in Manchester, you could come and join that one if you want. Or if you live in Liverpool, we did our first session yesterday. So that's on the 15th of March. So it's always the second Wednesday and the third Wednesday of the month. And the monthly book club is always the first Thursday of the month. We're also doing, for those that want to do calling in the one, 9-week workshop that starts on the 5th of March. If you've already put your name down on that a few weeks back, please message me to say that you want you join it. I'll actually lost my list and I can only have 20 people on that session. It is a 9-week workshop, pretty intense, and is our only paid session for the book club. So if you want details for that, just message me. We've got Hear My Voice Book Club Weekend Away, which is connecting to the now. That's the 8th of April to the 10th of April. It's going to be in Stockport near Manchester, and it'll be 2 days of full of this. For those that have already been, we wake up early and it doesn't finish until 10 o'clock at night. It is full, putting all these teachings into practice. We also have WhatsApp group, because I'm very much about keeping people connected. We have a 5 a.m. club WhatsApp group. We have the socials, which is a really busy one where people just support each other. We've got the information WhatsApp group, which is just me that shares. We've also got Jodie Spencer, as we've got quite a lot of Jodie Spencer fans. That is just for Jodie Spencer. And we have calling in the one for those that are on the workshop. And for those that know that I'm writing my own book, Wiggle Your Damn Toes. If you want to read a bit of my story, I'm not going to go into it now because we're going to go straight into the session. But if you want to go and read a bit of my story, or you want to support in getting this book out there, because I will be putting it on workshops just the way I do with every book that I read. So we're going to start off with some shoulder rolls. As most of you know, I like to get the body moving as well and just release your day. If you've got any tension in those shoulders, or if you just want to open up those energy centers, so choose a comfortable sitting position. And as you take a slow, deep breath in through your nose, lift your shoulders up towards your ear. And as you exhale, bring the shoulders back and down. And exhale through the mouth. If you've had a stressful day, you might want to give a big sigh out through your mouth. Nice deep breath in. And exhale. One more time, nice deep breath in. Really draw up those shoulders and exhale. And we like to get the body moving. So if you want to stand up and give your bodies a really good shake out, we'll play a little bit of music. For those that have not been to the session, even if you want to just sit in your seat and just get your body moving in that way, but just get some foot moving, let shift some energy from the body. Give it a really good shake. Take a seat. So I'm going to hand it over to Shams, who will be hosting this session. I'll just be clicking the slides. So,
thank you, Yinka. Am I clear?
Yes, you're clear.
Oh, perfect. Hi, everyone. Whilst you're on here, wish me luck. So this session, to be honest, was brought together with an intention of spreading the love. Yinka kindly said, listen, let's share this, which she does so beautifully on all the sessions. I'm sure you all agree. So as we just heard in the song, live your life, live your life. It's your life. And really, that's what the session is about. Mastering is about the first step, is recognizing yourself as the master in your own story. And that's the essence of the book, is about you connecting to that master. And in order to do that, you recognize yourself as the student and the teacher, because there's much to learn, unlearn, and in doing what Yinka is doing by sharing, it's also another process of the whole mastery of growing and learning, because by teaching you absolutely learn, or by sharing. So this is really the purpose of tonight for me on this platform. Or everything, you know, it's talking about this book is essentially reminding us, you know, when we're looking for love, when we're searching for love, when we, I don't know, even the idea of hunting it down, you know, that desperation that you feel, it's not out there. It's really starting with in us, you know, whatever you're looking for, you've got to absolutely connect with it internally. That's the essence of the book. So we'll delve into it as we unpack the session, shall we say, because what we're doing here is really not much of teaching. It's a sense of sharing. And when you read the book, you've absolutely heard these words in other books, on other platforms, through other voices. You know, it's one echo of the same message, and it's just a different tone. And that's why it depends on where you're at, that it hits you differently. So any book, it doesn't have to be a new book. It could be the same damn book. It could be the same poem. But last week, I read it differently from this week. You know, last month, in my last lifetime, you know, and that's really just finding out where we at, and just being able to, in order to do that, Yinka and I were just talking about, you know, hosting a platform sometimes. People have people are coming in from different perspectives. So everybody absolutely is bound to have a story to tell. You know, if I put out the word trauma, I bet you we can bet each other $1 million that everybody resonates with that word, because we come from somewhere. And the mere fact that we're on such a platform says we've come from somewhere and we're looking to go somewhere else. So we're saying, let's silence, let's mute the story of trauma, and let's just share in that trauma initially that we're talking about was necessary, absolutely necessary to get us to where we are. And so in this moment, we're talking about celebrating ourselves. In this moment, we're talking about mastering and the idea of seeing, of witnessing the master in ourselves. Yes, everyone on board, thumbs up. Okay, so.
Can I just share that? I'm going to leave the chat open. So it's going to be muted. So if you want to put comments in, send Shan some support and some love, you can do that through the chat. And as we go through it occasionally, I'll just share what's in the chat.
All right. Yinka, for now, you can take my face off the screen and just put it all the videos on if you want.
You can turn your camera off.
Oh yeah, but I just meant my face off the screen. I meant the ad. Yeah.
Oh, on the main screen, they see just what's on the screen. They don't see that. I don't think only some screens will have a little version of you on it.
Ah, okay.
You're just seeing a big version of yourself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, not everyone sees that. They'll see what I've put on the screen.
Oh, perfect. Perfect. So, going back to the beginning, it's always a good place to start, isn't it? So we look at where we are, to where we go, and that's the beginning, right? So back in the day, the Toltecs, they got together, and they were men and women of knowledge, and they had their gatherings as scientists and artists in their society, and to explore and to conserve the spiritual knowledge and the practices. And they came together as masters and students. So again, they were scientists and artists.
Don't read the chat. You just focus on what you're doing.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. You've attracted some people. So yeah, we'll just ignore them. I'm going to say to everyone, just ignore them. They may learn something today. If you want to send Shams love or a question, put that in the chat. But ignore those that have popped into share inappropriate stuff. We're just going to ignore that and send our vibration to Shams and these teachings.
Wow, interesting. I had a little nap this afternoon, and I did actually have an idea that there were going to be some hackers, which may have happened before. But it was interesting because, as you said, when we're screaming out, when we're screaming out the way these guys are screaming out with pseudonames, absolutely not their own, and using names from certain communities, to project whatever it is, it's coming from a place of hurt. It's coming from a place of pain. It's coming from a place of unpeace. It's coming from a place of darkness or regret. And this is the only expression that they know of how to express it. And in a sense, when Yinka says ignore and not react and not respond, it's also about observing other people, because they talk from their trauma place, and it's the only place that they know. And so it's through, it may not stop here. They may find other platforms. They'll continue until they move out of their trauma, which is a great opening for us. So actually we could thank them, because when we look at us, when we are born into this experience, we come through a traumatic physical experience, the birthing trauma. And we could stay stuck in that word of trauma, or we could use it as a birthing process. So that trauma becomes a birthing process to move into a life of adventure. And so notice what we're doing. We're talking of the same experience, but we're rewording it, because then we experience it differently. So that's all it is. So, you know, when people are coming through on chats, it's words. When people are exchanging themselves in conversation, it's words that are being, it's energy that's coming out from where they are. You know, that story, you can only squeeze out lemon juice from lemons. You know, you can't squeeze a lemon and expect apple juice, you know, and the squeezing is necessary. So when we talk about the scientist and artist that came together to explore and to conserve the spiritual knowledge and practices of the ancients, and they came together as masters and students, let's stop right there. Are we not coming together creatively as artists, discussing this idea of love in a way that's, in a sense, science is life, in a way of how can we science this out? How can we express this in our day-to-day living, which is science? And how can we move towards exploring this and conserve it in a way that we can hold on to some of the truths that resonate with us, that's conserving it? And then how can we experience it, which is the practice of it? And how then do we share this in a communal sense, first with our own internal communities, and then in our immediate surroundings? How can we then express ourselves on our own immediate families and friendship circles? And so are we not then doing this? That's the point. How can we recognize ourselves as Toltec in our now, in our civilization, in our culture that we are creating right now, as masters and students both at the same time? So welcome, Toltecs. Oh, bless you, Yinka.
Yeah.
This is the behind the scenes. Yes. Our backup is in place. Have no fear, Yinka's in the backup.
Yeah.
Bless you. All right.
So if you when you want me to share the slides, just say.
Yeah, so if you can put up this, by what we've just done of the Toltec, can we have the slide of the Toltec, you know, that first page? So I'm going to say it out. The Toltec is an artist of love.
The first page?
Yeah, the first one. Do you remember the page from the book?
Oh. Sorry. That's
no. Well,
no, so that's a bit further on.
Yeah, if you can find that one. I'll read it out. So,
do you want to go through the slides until you get... Oh, yeah, you read it out. And then
So as we read through this, the reason why we said pen and paper, everyone, is because, as Yinka may have mentioned on other sessions and to the newbies as well, and you may have heard it elsewhere, is when sometimes when you put pen to paper, simply, there's an imprint that imprints on our mind and soul and spirit in a different way as well. So whatever the words that are being shared tonight, if there's any word that sort of resonates with you, just put that down. And what we're doing is we're encouraging you to doodle, let's say, doodle. And by doodling it and by putting your intention in your heart in that word, you just resonate with it and it expands the word. It gives it breath. And that's really what we want. So I'm going to read that beginning, which is brilliant, which is definition of Toltec. See if you can find a word in there, a word or two words that resonate with you. And do like a doodle. I don't know if you can see some, Yinka, can you see this?
Yeah, go and show it.
Yeah, if you can just, you know, see some of the words.
Put it in front of you.
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay. This is just my own words. It's not from the Toltec. Find your own words. but these are words that I find resonates with the word love, mastering of love. So piece of paper, get creative with it.
I'll just stop it a minute so everyone can see it.
Oh yeah.
Go on.
Okay, can you see it? Well, just thumbs up, we'll be fine.
Well, yeah. First, a bit further over.
Further over what?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, there you go. Okay. Yeah. Oh. Okay, so just, you know, I've just written it out. You can put a few dots, you can scroll, you know, feel free. But put that pen to paper and make it in a sense like as if it's a classroom situation where you are the master and you're mastering being a student. Does that make sense? Yes? Okay. So this is the words from the book, which I just absolutely love. A Toltec is an artist of love, an artist of the spirit, someone who is creating every moment, every second, the most beautiful art, the art of dreaming. Life is nothing but a dream. And if we were artists, then we would create our life with love. And our dream becomes a masterpiece of love. How good is that? How juicy is that? That's the definition of purpose. If ever you wondered what my life purpose is, there you have it. Being a Toltec, which we have just established that you are, there you go. There's your life piece written out for you.
If you want to put hearts in the chat, say if you like it or not, if you enjoyed that.
Yes, definitely. I'll repeat that. Okay. It's worth repeating, true. Yeah. Yes. A Toltec is an artist of love, an artist of the spirit, someone who is creating every moment, every second, the most beautiful art, the art of dreaming. Life is nothing but a dream. And if we were artists, then we would create our life with love. And our dream becomes a masterpiece of love. Yeah. So, you know, we could put it in the chat later. You know, just take a copy of that page or something or so. But what's also important is like in that conversation, in that exchange that we've just had, in that definition, in that defining you, it's like, is there a defining moment that you feel that you can resonate with that? And that's what we're looking for. So, fellow Toltecs, take a moment. Yinka, have you got some music there?
Say again.
Have you got some music there? Just take a moment.
What type of music?
Meditation. Just sound.
Off the plan.
I know.
I don't know where it is.
Just keep that music that was ready.
Do you want the beginning music we had?
Yeah, just music, no words, instrumental. Yes, sir. Oh, just a bit softer so I can hear my voice. That's it. Just for a minute. Oh, even softer than that. Yinka.
I'll do it.
Thank you, lovely.
I'm sorry.
All right. Right, so just for a minute, write Toltec on your paper. I am a Toltec, given what we've just said. Just for a minute, just redefine yourselves with I am a Toltec. Write a few words around being a Toltec. What does that mean to you? So we said a Toltec is an artist of love. Artist, what does that mean? That means play with it. Play with your color, play with your creativity, play with your words, play with your ideas of who you think you are. Play with the concepts that may have defined you previously and get flexible with it, right? So art is about that. Art is about being creative. And to get Toltec about yourself, really, right? It's the artist. And you're creating beautiful art, and you're dreaming. It's the art of dreaming. Did you notice how many times art was in there, right? So that's what it is. We are mastering. It's the art of loving. That's what we're looking for. And so get creative with this idea of Toltec just for a minute. And throughout the session on the platform, you can keep adding to that, keep adding to this new definition, this redefining, this refreshing, this rewiring, this remembering, yes, of the Toltecs that you are. Okay, so when we look at that's all. Everyone see what's on the screen. When we look at this mastery, essentially, when you move yourself to love, let's talk about falling in love or being in love or tripping in love or all of those things, you know, about love. So whatever it is that you love, the essence of it, whether it's your dog, you could love your neighbor, you could love your parents, whatever it is, you could, you know. You absolutely will go out. You will go out of your way because of this. And we're not talking of obligations. We're talking of because I care, because, you know, something in there, it's a fulfilling feeling. And we're talking about, whatever you're doing for that person, for love, right? So we're talking of basics. Like if you had a kid, it's like food, warmth, water, housing, you know. I know it's basic, but you try to do your best to fit the basics. You're not, you know, there's no sense of like someone needs to beg you when we're talking about this beautiful love story. There's a sense of I do without them asking. And it's not even a sense of it's my duty. I do it because I love doing it. And that's where we want to go with the story. The sense of no obligation, the sense that from my side that there's no obligation, and from the other side that they don't need to beg. So there isn't this the sense of conditional, the sense of bargaining, the sense of I do so that she does, you know, and you know, there isn't that sense at all. It's just about you, right? This is where we're talking from the space that we can express this beginning of mastery, right? It's absolutely not external. It's absolutely such a, regardless of the external factor, regardless of I love that person so much and they're in a bad mood, but either way, I will be making a cup of tea, for example, right? And that's because I make a cup of tea and I'm doing it out of love, whether they're in a foul mood or not. That's what I do and it's what I enjoy doing. And that's what we're talking about. So when we recognize that in that, I am the master of me doing, I'm the master of creating that, right? Regardless of whatever the wounds are on the outside, then I'm moving myself from a space of stability. I'm moving myself from my own treasure, from my own source, right? Regardless of the external. And this is where most of the time we need to operate from, right? Because all of this is, in the beginning, we talk about when you give that cup of tea and the person barks back at you, oh, why didn't you put sugar in there? Why didn't you stir it anti-clockwise? Why did you use that tea bag? Why did you use that cup? You know, that when the bark comes back, we can move ourselves into a wound, thinking, oh, well, next time, sod that. I'm not going to give you even a cup of tea. You're going to get coffee. I don't know, you know? I'm not going to use the favorite mug on you. You don't deserve it. So we move ourselves into the wound story, right? Because you did that, therefore I'm going to do this. And this is the beginning of when we start then into the negotiations, right? Because what's happened is that I did it from a place of my own knowledge, my own information. But then, so that was my own action. But then the reaction changed my action. So we then move ourselves into living in a very reactionary world. And this is the world that we are creating because we've responded to the reaction. That was our response. And so this is a question mark now. What kind of brewing do we want to do? Do we want to brew over something that's not worth it? Or do we want to make a brew that's going to be warm, nurturing, and filled with love, regardless of what's brewing on the outside? That's really moving ourselves from the wounded mind. And what happens is that one voice started something, that why did you not put enough sweetness in my tea? That was strike one, right? So now I'm on my back foot, aren't I? So the next time I'll be like doing a few things, but I'll do it with caution. I'll be precautious. I'll not be moving freely. I'll not be moving with, you know, that much love. I'll be moving forward with conditions because I'm moving forward with a wound that I decided that I was going to take on, I was going to hold on to. And so what happens is we start this dis-ease. We start this, the tea was heaven. My initial action was heaven. And then my response to the reaction, I started my hell story. And this is where we start the hell story, okay? We start creating this lie. We start creating this story. We start creating this trauma, this pain, okay, that we now take on. And what happens is that if you build it up slowly, because now, well, she and I and you and me and next time, and I'm having this internal conversation, which is the beginning of a little war. Now, in Sufism, they call this, actually, it's redefined, because I know jihad sounds like out there, but this is what is meant in Sufism by the jihad. It becomes the internal struggle of this idea of my soul and my mind games and my heart. And, you know, there's all these pulling factors now about what I think was meant and what should have been and what could have been. And can you hear the noise? It's noisy, isn't it? This is how we create the chaos. This is how we move ourselves into that wounded mind. And now because there's so much noise going on in that head of us, right? It's a bit heavy, isn't it? And so we start doing this. We start getting the neck ache. We've got the world on our shoulders. You see how it started? And then you see, like, because I made a cup of tea with love here. Then when I went to the office, I was thinking, oh, but what if Sarah's like that? And then what if John doesn't like this cup? And then I started thinking, oh no, or maybe I shouldn't just forget it. I'm just not making tea for anybody, you know? Because what is the point, you know? You know, it's like you've got to cross your T's, you know that story? Yeah, well, now I'm over precautious. I'm starting putting boundaries and I'm like keeping the world out there, and I'm definitely not going to be stirring anybody with sweetness. Yeah. So I just making it quite simplistic, but actually it's the simple stories that gets us complicated, because it's a simple plus the simple plus the simple, and then it equals complications, right? So we move ourselves into complicationships, right? And really sometimes it's about our internal wound in the mind. So we move ourselves into the judgment of like, what if maybe I shouldn't, maybe I could have done better, maybe if I timed it better, maybe if I, can you hear that? You start doing that on ourselves. And then basically my tea, the way I make it, is just not good enough, right? So then I start this, and then I become self, I punish myself, right, with this story. I start my own suffering, and then I move myself into fear, you know, fear of what if I don't get it right? Fear of what if it's not appreciated? What if it's not, you know, welcomed with the love that I give it? What if it's not reciprocated with the love that I give, and then I don't get that love back? What if, okay? And this what if keeps us stuck in this wounded mind. And then we also start at a young point in when growing up, we can be, you know, we've got role models. So initially they are our parents. Let's just move into like the idealistic picture, you know, your parents are the role models. And you see these adults screaming at each other, having arguments. And you just think, oh my God, is that my role model? As a child, you're not thinking that about role models, but you do look up to your parents, don't you? And they may not be able to assess the emotions, deal with the emotions, you know, and they, you know, screaming, having arguments all the time, overworking themselves, and you know, if they need to spend time with you, they buy you an expensive gift, and you know, and then you tell your friend who doesn't get any gifts, you tell them, oh, I wish I had your parents, because at least you get to spend time with them. And your friend's thinking, oh, I wish I had your parents, because I get to have the gifts that you get. You know, we start having these conversations, right? It's about like role models. We start looking up to, like, you know, Marvel characters are great because they introduced to us at that point about all our superheroes, or sports people that come along, or, you know, we can't say, oh, you know, some leaderships, because if you look at leaderships across the world, they're struggling. You can just see it's all egos up there at the moment. So we get it, you know, teachers, we look up to teachers because, you know, they're in the space of teaching. And so you think, right, I could learn from these, you know, role models at school. And then you find out that they're not as perfect as you thought they were as well, you know, some of these teachers. You look up to, I don't know, back in the day, you look up to like priests or gurus, and you find out, oops, they've had something dark in their past, or, you know, they're out there doing some lewd acts. And, you know, so your world of this role models is crumbling. It's all part of the wounded mind story, right? So we grow up with these expectations, these images, these egos. And now what happens is that we need to move ourselves to this, what is real? What is authentic? What is true? What is the self? What is this, you know? At the moment, you know, I am rejected. Someone else is rejecting me, right? And now there's the story of rejection that's going on. And in all of this, I'm also looking for someone who accepts me, but I'm so busy rejecting myself. But I'm looking in this world where everybody's so busy rejecting themselves and what is external. I'm looking for someone else out there to be a bit more accepting of me, of the me that I reject. Can you hear what we're doing? Can we hear the games that we're playing? You know, and we need to call it. And this is what we're doing here. We're calling it. We're just saying, listen, what game do you want to play? So in this loss of innocence that's going on, we are trying to move ourselves to all of this when we're witnessing and observing and seeing. All of this is part of the exploration, right? Because it's important to sometimes see what you don't want, to know what you do want as well. You know, that constriction will move you into expansion, as we said about like birth, the way we came in so that we can expand into this life adventure. So what's happening is that we came in a sense in innocent, you know, untarnished, you know, and just new and just like buzzing and saying, right, what's happening here? And every time we move ourselves into rebirthing, which is a process that's happening right now, we are then saying, right, where am I and who is my role model and what quality of Toltec am I right here, right now? It's a rebirthing. And what sense of life adventure do I want to now expand into, regardless of considering the trauma that I've had? That depends on where you're at, right? So the trauma that I've past tense had, right? And what am I going to move into? He makes a mention of something as bad as in the book, as someone being sexually abused. He said that may have taken, that experience may have taken an hour, I don't know, 2 hours, I'm not sure. That traumatic experience, right? Let's put it down to 2 hours. And what happens from that is that we move ourselves into 20 years of suffering for that 2 hours that happened. And so this is important. People's experience and people's stories and people's trauma and people's am I clear, Yinka?
I was muted. Yes, you're clear. I can hear.
Oh, okay. Right. Yeah, so so that 2 hours becomes a 20 year for some people. And you know, it could move into a lifetime. And we really have to get a grip on it, you know. I mean, there's different levels of trauma. You know, right now there's the earthquake that's going on, you know, in I say going on because it's still the after effects, you know, in Turkey and Syria. And these, you know, people have lost a lot. You know, there's many stories of on that scale that has happened, right? And so they have to rebirth themselves into a new story. And you know, this is personal. So that's external, it's out there, but it's internal. Because when it happens, it's like, well, how do we process it immediately in our own lives? How do we process those earthquakes that hit us internally? And then how do we rebirth ourselves into this new story? How do we move from that? My world was so perfect, and then that happened, right? So this is what we're exploring here today. And he moves us into a lighter tone of saying play. To say play. That this will, as a Toltec said, is life is nothing but a dream. And so how do we dream ourselves out of this? How do we artistically move ourselves into creating another dream, into dreaming another dream, right? And people are, you know, it's all about, at the end of the day, the more we develop, the more we become sensitive, in the sense of the more we're able to listen to our guts, listen to our bodies, and listen to our inner voices, because you're tuning. All you're doing is you're fine-tuning the frequencies, right? You're fine-tuning your energies, you're fine-tuning your vibes, and so that you are able to listen to the notes, so that you can play in a different way, and you can get playful with it, and you can get creative with it. So, you know, from the mum and dad saying, you know, when you put your finger in the plug or something in the song, stop, don't do it, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, your curiosity was like, oh, you know, first was like the shock, you know, that's like, don't do it. Or, you know, they, you know, all these threats. So if you do it, this will happen, you know, you die, okay? And then what happens is you eventually find out that this will happen. So you cannot miss out in some sense. You can take the warning and all of that. The best experience, the best learning is through the experience. Regardless of what so many people told you, you went for it. Yeah. You decided that, you know what, this person, I understand they're not good for me, but I think I'll be good for them. Whatever, you were warned, you went in there and you thought this time is going to be different. Let's put it that way, for example, right? And you learned, you experienced, but you know what? You didn't learn so much about that person externally. You didn't learn about the blood bond. You didn't learn about, you learned about yourself. You learned about how far you're willing to go. How much are you willing to compromise? How much do you want to hear? How much do you want to listen? How much do you want to experience? Every experience that you've learned more about yourself. So play with it. That's the point. Just play with us, because if we move ourselves into this other story, this is when we start that. Poor me. I put my finger in the socket and I got blown to smithereens, and that's why my hair looks the way it does. Do you know what I mean? It's up to you what story you want to tell, you know? Embrace it. I think I saw you smiling there, fellow hair raiser. So this is it. It's like, right, I've been wounded. Let's all agree we've all been wounded. We've all been in trauma. Everybody to different degrees and different stories, different perspectives, different lifestyles, different experiences. Yes, we have past tense. Now, what are we planning to do with that, right? So it may have moved us. Yinka is sitting here on this platform, okay? And she told you about the story about wiggling her damn toes. I mean, but that's what you can swift. You can use that moment to shift your story and say, right, that experience was necessary because I can tell the story in the sense of growth, in the sense of development, in the sense of healing, in the sense of, right? Or Yinka, you could write another book and just tell us about how you were in pain and how you almost died. I mean, really, I think that may be your bestseller, you know? Yeah. So we have the choice. That's really what I want to say, right? This is it. This is about choice and making our moments count, which is what he said. He said, someone who is creating every moment, every second, and that's what we're talking about. So because as much as we don't want to agree to it, life brings us exactly not what we want, brings us exactly what we need. It's to clean us, it's to heal us, and this is going to be a hard one. And maybe some of you have heard it before, but Rumi, Mevlana Rumi from Sufism says the same thing. And so does Eckhart Tolle, and so does all these guys, all these, I don't mean males, I just mean generic, all these masters and gurus and teachers and students echo the same story, that the pain and the suffering is a gift. And that's hard to swallow, What do you mean? I would choose that for myself. Do you mean I should be saying thank you for that? Yeah. You may not see it now, but in retrospect, when you see your growth, you'll say, well, I wouldn't have grown out of it, from it. I wouldn't have grown. I wouldn't have expanded if I didn't have that. And so that's what it is. It's like, how do we then take our 40 years of a story and say, right, you know what? Oh, that was really necessary for me. And it's one word I got out of that: forgiveness. I mean, that's a big word. But listen, I understand you're a moron. I understand you're an idiot, right? So I can put that in that box. But at that point, I'm just not ready to forgive. And sometimes, mostly, I'm not ready to forgive myself. I can't believe me that's so clever, so smart, so I know it all, I've read it all, I should know better. I actually decided to make the choice to go for that silly decision, right? So then it's about like forgiveness of self. And what do we do then with that story? We're like, it's easier saying, well, she did this to me and therefore he did that, you know, no. And the world was, and they did, and you know, so the externals upon me and therefore poor me. And you see, and then we start that poor me story, okay? And we're just saying, listen, it's up to you. You can continue that story, but it's noisy for yourself, actually, more than anybody else, right? So let's mute that, right? Let's just mute it for a bit, and let's just move into the playfulness of this, right? I was born into this adventure. How about we change that story? My parents wanted a child, and therefore I'm born, and now I have to put up with this stuff. They made the choice that they wanted a kid. And so you change that story and just say, I was up there, move further beyond that. And just say, I was up there, I looked at the stuff and I said, yo, I want to play that game. Okay, those two that seem to not have it together, I'll go in there and I'm going to be playful with them. And they're going to be my parents. And then those clowns around them that's called my family, okay, I'm going to just see what I can do with the circus that's going on and with my family. So if you put yourself in the driving seat, in the sense that you dreamt this and you said, yes, I want to play, this is my adventure, I'm ready for it, you take ownership, you become the master of that story and say, right, I made you a choice, right? I made this decision a choice, right? No matter where, no matter what the circumstance. And then you start playing it because your mindset is different. You own it. You own your shit. You know, you own your story. You own it. And then you see differently. Say, right, now, how do I want to play this? And you stop seeing yourself as a little chess piece that's being moved around. You become the player of the chess board, right? And that's what we're talking about. This is toltec-ing yourself, right? This is saying, I'm going to dream the dream that I had, because up there I had an idea. And so I thought that I'm quite capable of doing it. And so I'm just going to do my best. That's all. Nobody's saying, listen, I'm just saying, just do your best. You know what? Along the way, just understand this is a little dream. It's a game. It's all of this. Why? It's because your soul has needed a lesson. And the lesson may have just been to learn to love. Didn't mean other people. You could have learned to love your houseplant. Yeah? No, seriously. Because from loving the houseplant, you thought, oh, wait, if I can do this, I can do another one. And then you start loving your garden. And then the planet is a bigger garden. You start loving nature. You start going out and hiking. Do you see what I mean? You take that small thing that you love. And this is when Yinka said, bring something to the table that you bring with love. Start somewhere with that thing that you know is love. Stay there. If it's your dog, if it's your pillow that you need to go to bed, but you know that that pillow makes you love, you're sleeping, stay there. Nobody's judging you. Stay there. And just, you know, start there. When you know, when you put your head in your pillow, because of that pillow, you're having better dreams. You know, you're able to rest. You're able to like just absorb the whole day. You're just able to appreciate that you've got a pillow under your head and you can lay your heavy noise on a pillow. Yeah, you know, something like that. Start at the point that you feel like, if I love that food, man, eat that food every day. Stay there until you expand your varieties and you expand your cuisine and you move yourself into cooking and cooking your own. Yeah, that's what we're talking about. So on the word play, Yinka, where are we at? Are we okay?
We're on playful.
All right. So on this word of playful, I don't remember the order, but is this like at this point, think about how do you want to play better? Do you want to play better? Just again, for a second, I say minute, but I'm not counting the seconds here, okay? Just for a second on that pen to paper, put the word boldly, play, and think about it. How do you want to, where do you want to play better? Do you want to play better in sport? Do you want to play better in your relationships? Do you want to play better mind games with yourself? Do you want to really play better chess? Do you want to play better with your kids? Do you want to play better with your friends? Do you want to play better with your family? Do you want to play better with all of the self-development stuff, you know? Do you want to lighten up and pass the ball and think about new things, you know? Or what do you want to do? That's, so just put the word play. Do you want to play with your cupboards and your closets? Do you want to play with your colors? Do you want to play with your toys, you know? Do you want to play with your spanners and your screwdrivers and your cars and your oil and, you know, what do you want to play with? Just put play. This is your story. How are you going to play this out in a better way, right? Doodle that. And if you feel like the video, are the videos on? If you feel like the video, like if you feel like sharing, just put your page up there. Right. How are we? Huh? How are we doing? Thumbs up or put some, you know, notes in the chat. Everyone on board, are you okay with the session? Yeah, good. Right, that's the, now, that's the new definition of your life, right? First we redefined yourself, lovely. Now we are redefining the life purpose. And the word is play. That's it. Full stop. Okay. So Toltecs, how are you planning to play? Right. In the book, there's this lovely story and I've got to share. I said to Yinka, right. It's a story about this guy and he didn't believe in love. And I may have to refer to my notes, but it's good. And, you know, he was like, oh, no, love gives you heartbreak and it's filled with sadness. And, you know, it's just in books and in movies and, you know, stories. And, you know, it's like it's just used to manipulate. It's like, you know, it's like drugs. And you get needy with this whole story. Look at my face, how annoyed I am. You get needy with this whole story of love. It's out there and it's too much hard work. Oh, my God, try the dating apps. You know, it's like everybody's somebody else and pretending to be in. and it's just like, listen, it's just no point. And then you move into addiction, you know, and then sometimes you just need antidepressants to get over the whole story or to deal with the whole story or to cope with it, or, you know, just keep going on with the story. And then guess what? You met a woman, and this woman, she was bang on with this hurt story. She was like, man, I totally resonate with you. You're my soulmate. You're speaking words that are true. Absolutely love it. We both don't believe in love. And so they spent a long time, as much as they could, every other day, getting together, not believing in love. It was brilliant, right? Perfect setup, right? And then she was doubting, and he was doubting, and they were sharing their doubts, and they're talking about the trip-ups, you know. Well, you know, and then anyway, one day, a silly guy thought, oh, bummer, I think I love her. I mean, I love that she doesn't believe in love, right? I mean, this is just, maybe this is the feeling, you know, like this closeness, this connection, this resonating on the same words and the same vibe and the same BS energy, you know, this must be love, you know? And then he said to her, listen, I might actually give you this star, you know, because I just think you totally resonate with me. Then guess what happened to her? She was like, man, this is too big. This is a responsibility. You're now giving me something external that I need to be responsible for because of how you're feeling, right? And so she was like, no, happiness can't come externally. It's got to come from only from inside us, right? So she was saying this. And the problem here is that I cannot be responsible for your happiness now. And so guess what happened with them? They just grew apart and they didn't see each other and they lived very sad lives and they never saw each other again. And this is the story of where a lot of us are, the man who didn't believe in love. Isn't it a simple story of ourselves? I got together with this woman. She seemed to have come from the same experience. I got together with, met a friend and we just clicked because we both had a shitty past and, you know, we absolutely hang out and we have a great time together. You know, don't we sometimes do that to ourselves? Yeah. Because we don't believe in what? Is it love or is it ourselves? Because we're moving with matching up our what? Insecurities, our vulnerabilities, our fears. And so we're thinking, right, that's a good match, right? And so you put that together and then you're bound to have something that's may not actually work, right? And so we've got to move towards being consistent about checking our vibrations, about, you know, I cannot be asking for something out there that I'm not vibing in a sense, right? So, you know, on Yinka's platforms, law of attraction, I can attract what I'm at, right? Where I'm at or what I'm at, what I am, sorry, you know? And so this is the whole conversation, toltecs. Where are we at? Because if we are talking about that trauma past, right? And then in that conversation, because we're saying, I am that. And in that conversation, we say, and now I want something else. Well, no, you need to say, I am something else so that you can get something else. Right? Because what's happening is that we have like a track, you know how people say a track record, right? So that's it, right? The past is a track record. And so it depends what we want to record on our track, right? What music do you want to record on your track so that you can humdrum that sing song all day long and vibrate it out? So what's your track record? That's really the question. You know, what music are you playing to? What music do you want to dance to, right? So your track record, is it the track record of a love story or is it the track record of fear, right? Where you at, what vibration, what frequency, what vibe, what energy, what all of those fancy words. Anyway, you, what is your being, right? Because it's absolutely about, you know, what do you want out there, if it is, or in here to respond to, what level, right? What kind of sweetness, how much of sugar, you know? Or I mean the good sugar, honey. How much of honey do you want, you know? To what quality of it do you want to respond to? Well, then be that honey, that's the point, right? be that honey. So the quality depends on your choices, right? We're not saying, listen, this idea that if I'm not feeling well, I need to take something. Listen, feeling unwell is part of the process. You know, we have a quick fix solution in our culture to say that if I'm not feeling this happiness, then something is wrong with me. Well, therein lies the problem. That concept is wrong. Feeling imbalanced, feeling all of those things is part of the process. It's this acceptance, right? That happy pill is not going to fix the story inside. It may subdue, it may, but internally that story is still there. So the moving ourselves towards the happy quick fix is just saying that I'm not accepting this imbalanced situation because I expect, because in my mind, I expect that all my days should be heaven, all my days should be peaceful, and all my days should be sweet. But that's not the definition of life, is it? I mean, at which point in that sweet story are you planning to grow? Right? You know, your mama's made your food and she's ironed your socks and your bed sheet. And at which point are you planning to learn how to cook or how to, you know, make your own bed? See what I mean? And like, oh no, mama's not doing it. It's making me feel unwell. I don't like it. The world's not doing what I expect because that's my happy story. Then we get unwell. We move into ourselves into, because mama doing it was ease. And now this other story is dis-ease. But isn't that the process of growth? Right? So redefining again, right? Moving into not this idea of chores, but in this idea of if I want to play this game, then this is how, you know, I got, you know, there's certain things how I need to play it out, right? So this need to, have to, must, should, oh my God, there's so many. I'm just feeling heavy thinking about those words, but yeah, you know, because I don't know, it's expected of me, my family are like that, my culture's been like that, you know, I fit into this role, Okay, it's draining, stop it, okay, all of us. And moving to want to, I would like to, I desire, I prefer, choices. Well, you know, if we soften that, the tone, if we soften those words, notice how the need to and it's all like I've committed myself to it. I've signed this deal that I'm not, you see, it's a bit of a dragging. But if I move myself into this other one, let's prefer, you move yourself into the master talk, right? You move yourself into the want to, into the desire, into the dreaming talk, into the building, the creating talk. And this is important. The softness of words that sit well with you, you know, you can actually feel that it's just that you can feel the expansion of it. You can feel the growth in it. Watch ourselves. You know, this whole thing, absolutely, this whole process is about observing, self-observation. We talk self-awareness, selfless. It's just about listening to ourselves, self-observation, observe. Could I choose a better word? Could I be more, could I master my own speech, right? Could I master my own output? Could I, you know, how they say, you know, this is the master mix, yeah? You know, there's like one, you know, you have one chance at it, you know? Once it's out there, it's out there. So like the world can play with it. Because every time we put it out there, every time we put out our master mix of words, just think about, right, what's your big hit that you want to, you know, go out with? What are the words that you want to say, right? And sometimes we said it and we think, no, maybe not that word. It's okay to do that because it's a process. You're growing with the word. And you'll notice that when you start being a little more gentler on yourself, your whole being is gentler. So your words are gentler. But when you're hard on yourself, right, you're hard on the world, right? Like those guys that came in on the chat, right? It's, they're only doing what's in them, right? So just that, you know, the whole thing about mastering, you think it's all about like, I need to do this, I need to be more disciplined. Actually, the whole thing is about being less doing and being softer, less, more accepting, just more gentler. Just that's the self-care, right? It's not so much about doing. Like we said before, it may just be about editing, right? The story is written sometimes. And sometimes we come in and we just edit it and just say, right, okay, that was, you know, because it's a, you know, it's a tune that's going on. I'm just going to edit that and edit that. And this is the unlearning process, right? So shall we have a silence for a minute? I mean, there is a lot of silence going on here with you guys muted. But what I mean is, in your own minds, 7 moments of silence.
Do you want to mute yourself and then I'll click on timer?
Quality. Silence seems a long time when we have to sit with ourselves. So in this playful sport, just before we move on to the next, the magical kitchen, is I just, you know, it's like, let's say if you're playing a game of tennis, right? So you're playing doubles in a tennis game. Just think about any game, like, and you're so concerned about the other person's shots over the net. That you, so this game is just like, listen, let's just go social and we just get together. But and the, what is, remember what was the point? The point was to have fun. Remember that. And all you're doing is you, with the person next to you, you're just critting. Oh, hit the shot like this, serve it like this, do this. Can you see? And then it becomes unfun. And all you're doing is making it unfun when it's just supposed to be playing this game. And the quality of it is just about the choices. But it won't become a sport if you want to keep making that person's game a lot more like your game, which is what we do in relationships, right? They just not doing it the way I want it to be done. They just not are the way I want them to be. And we have this relationship with our kids as well, right? You know, that we kind of like trying to mold them into what we know, which is ourselves. And this is then how we move ourselves into the unfun of it. And all we're saying is, how do we practice creating that, allowing somebody else also to create their own game? This is important. You know, it's like it says in the book, like a dog, you know, a dog is a dog. And if you keep expecting the dog to be a cat, waiting for it to meow, it's not going to happen, mate. So at some point, it's about realization of acceptance. Like, and that's the way we want the world to be. Well, that's the way I am. Accept me. They just don't accept me. Nobody understands me. But we have this expectation about the world, what the world should be doing with us. And yet we are so busy, you know, criticizing the world out there. And I say the world, I mean, ourselves. That's the world beyond us when we look at ourselves. Oh, I wish you weren't so fat. I wish you weren't so, oh, stupid me or silly me. Or, you know, we do that unconsciously, right? And so this is about the softness, how to bring the softness, how to bring the art into it, and using our imagination to tell someone else, listen, keep quiet. But is there another way to do it? Is there a better way? Is there a new way? Is there another way that we could sign ourselves into, like, into this contract with each other? Because into this relationship with each other? Into this, is there a new possibility? Is there a new way, new technique, new, just throwing it out there, you know? You'll be surprised at yourself, actually, more than the response sometimes when you allow this and you become, in a sense, this love and this respecting others so that they can respect you, you know? So respect is a big word, but it has to be thrown in there. I have to absolutely respect that you're not going to meow because you're a dog. That's it, right? Sarah is not going to be Susan and Tom is not going to be Stephen. That's it, right? Just acceptance. That's what we're talking about. And guess what? I am not going to be my mom and I'm not going to be, I don't know, you know? I mean, I want to be J-Lo or Shakira, but like, I'm not going to be because I'm too busy being myself. But like, you're going to have to chill with that and understand that I'm here. I'm being me at the best way I can be. And this is where we have to move, right? But first from ourselves to self-acceptance, right? When we're easy with ourselves, we can be easier with others. So in this like magical kitchen that we're moving into on the slide, it's like food. I like the story. So it's like food, right? There you are. You're busy creating this brilliant meal. You're having the best time throwing in all your spices, not following a recipe, feeling it out, thinking, right, a pinch of salt, that's it. You know, a handful of, that's it, you know. And you're just having a great time. Come up and the food is wholesome and you're loving it. Because why? You're cooking with love. And then somebody comes and you know what? You've just cooked with so much of love that you have enough. You have enough for like, yo, I've got enough. Come and get some. I've got a Tupperware for you. You know, I've got enough to share. So much because I'm just making magic here. And then somebody comes along and they say, listen, I am willing to bring you pizzas every day. You don't have to cook, right? And you're like, yeah, but I don't need pizzas, mate. And I say, yeah, but think about it. You know, I could bring in my pizza and, you know, you wouldn't need to get in your kitchen and, you know, save you all the time and all the ingredients. And like, yeah, but I really don't need. So when you don't need, guess what? I'm the master of this kitchen. I'm the master of my cooking. I'm the master of my meal. I'm in my element. I'm in my zone. I'm in my kingdom. I'm rocking it. When someone else is bringing in that pizza, right? Now you're going to start thinking, right? Okay, but I don't like this cheese and then maybe that. And yeah, but then I, you know, but the time the pizza comes, I need it to be warm and, you know, I don't want to reheat pizza. And can you hear that conversation that's going on, right? So now what's happening is like, at this, you know, what a gift, pizza, free pizza coming in. And I'm like, you know, because now what's happening is that I'm moving myself into a contract here. I'm moving myself into conditional, right? So now it's, you know, person's giving the pizza, but like now, what, do I give them money or do I have to repay them with, you know, it's like move myself into that, like, okay, how do I barter this? Because I'm sure it's, you know, a give and take situation. And then it becomes like, oh, the pizza's not here. I'm hungry. I'm starving. And I'm needy. I'm moving myself into needy. And, oh, you know, okay. So I'm sorry. I was late. Can you see what's happening here? And then over time with this pizza story, now my system is, listen, I'm enjoying this pizza. Now, what? You can't bring the pizza tonight. What the hell am I going to eat? I've just become addicted to this pizza story. Yeah. So can you see what we do, right? This love is supposed to be nourishing, right? This, you know, where we're busy in our kitchen and then we move ourselves into these pizza stories, you know? So how do you want to piece that together? How, you know, what do you want to do, you know, with this story of how do you want to nurture yourself? How do you want to feed yourself? You know, how do you want to share? How do you want to feed others, right? So this is the story of your magical kitchen. It's a game, play it, right? So even when you're in the kitchen, experiment, right? It's explore, experiment, it's an adventure. Just enjoy it, right? Change it, change the recipes, you know? Try something different. Move out of what you think you know into other areas, right? So try the pizza, but think about when you're moving yourself into the needy and the addictive and the I don't like this and I prefer that and what time and how warm you need to be. And I mean, the pizza needs to be, you know? Okay, so acceptance and this new beginning. And know that through this development, every story, whatever your story, there is healing in that story, okay? You are the controller. You decide on your action. And yes, there will be a response. There will be reaction. But then how do you respond to the response? How do you react to the reaction? Which is down to your action. And this is important, right? Because the world will definitely give you the karmic effect, right? It's necessary because it's energetic transfer. You have to have that. You may not have that the next minute, the immediate. 7 years down the line, you may have it. You don't know. But that cause and effect is bound to happen because it's part of the process of growth. So the only thing we control is what do we put out from our kitchen, right? What quality of foods do we want to put out to nourish? I mean, you could whip up some poison. You could whip up some toxic stuff, you know? There's many levels of it. But anyway, there's many stories to how you want to move from your kitchen. So it's about breaking the norms, breaking your old dreams, and this is a transformation. What is the growth in this is stalking, become stalkers. You know, you guys love that. Oh, let's see on Facebook, where are they? What are they doing? Were they connected to? Stalk yourself, stalk your responses, stalk your own reactions, and stalk like your working habits. And basically, this is going to take courage because you have to balls up to saying, I could have done better. I'm doing better. You know what I mean? This is where the honesty and the courage too comes in. And this is important because this is part of the self-love, right? So what are you expected? What are you expecting? And what are you expecting? What are you accepting? And what are you expecting? Let's put it that way, right? So what are you willing to tolerate? What values do you have? What level of care? What levels of considering? How much of your time are you willing to put out on this? You know, how much of your time are you willing to put out? But also how much of time are you willing to invest in yourself? It's like, you know, what quality of ingredients you in your kitchen and that's it. You say, listen, I'm going to my kitchen. I'm going to spend the whole day there. I'm going to spend like 2 hours in the kitchen. What am I doing? Okay. And that's up down to you. It's the quality of what do you want to cook up and how much time, how much ingredients. Basically, this is important. This is the part where you need to set yourself that program of saying, right, how much do I want to play in this kitchen? This is where your visualizing comes into this. Get juicy with it, you know, juice up your story. And, you know, the smoothies, great way, easy way, but, you know, that's down to you. How do you want to make this like task into a smoothie and just like make it easy, you know, to digest, you know? Yeah. Everyone okay with that? Right. Now, this part is interesting, which is about sex. So sex is Yinka, you there?
Yeah. So we have this one slide first.
Okay, yeah.
But you've already said it, but just so the slide's there.
So put the slide there because this is good. So this is what we're talking about. Like you're put out, right? Like what are you busy cooking up there and you're put out? What is that thing? What is it? Is it something external? Is it sitting with yourself and being quiet? Is it writing? Is it being on platforms? Like whatever it is that gives you that feeling. Do more of that feeling, because when you stay in that, then you'll grow into other feelings, but that are on this vibration of love, whatever it is. And it's different for everybody. You know, it could be, oh, I love it when I brush my hair. Oh, I love it when I have a bath. I love it when I walk. I love it when I breathe. What do you mean breathe? Yeah, we're all breathing. But when you take the time to breathe properly, deep breathe, it's a whole different experience. Some people love breathing, you know? So this is it. It's like, what is it for you? One word, put it in the chat, let's see, or write it on your paper and put it on the screen. What's that one thing? It could be sex, because that's the next topic.
You all know mine. I put mine in. Mine's books. What is yours? Put yours in the chat. Carla's put reading. You're in the great place then, Carla.
So, at the moment, aha, I love that. That's brilliant. Okay. Yes.
Perfect. So it's got nature.
Yeah. Right, so sex is the biggest demon in hell. I mean, that's the title of his chapter. I'm just saying to you what he's written in the book, right? And it's because, I mean, is it? Because sex is the thing that, you know, sex happened and then creation happened and then, you know. The problem is that we have like manipulated this thing with all our information and our judgments and our knowledge, and we've moved this joy, natural pure joy, to guilt and to shame, right? And we've moved it into like, you know, oh, it's a taboo word and we don't talk about it. And, you know, but sex is integral. It's in the intelligence of the DNA, you know, and there's like all these you know, the body, the you know, moving into the shame of the body and moving ourselves into detaching ourselves and, you know, not loving this and, you know, and the mind thinks it needs sex and the body wants love. So we start confusing our concepts, you know, like we move ourselves into, you know, is that the body or the mind speaking? And we, you know, are you the body or, you know, are you the mind or are you the soul or, you know, and they start doing this whole thing. And it's about sex, which is a natural process. So we need to sit comfortable with this because this here is something that creation has moved from. And in all levels of it, we're not just talking about male, female, in all levels of sexual play, you know, sexual understanding, sexual, you know, talk or things like that. Just lighten up with it again. Moving ourselves away from this ideas of what has been said about it into understanding that these words are life forces, both love and sex are life forces, and they're big words and they're beautiful words and they're creative words. And it's energy in those words that drives creation, that drives humanity, right? So reconnecting to those words and just connecting to the beauty of those words, again, moving into the softness of the words. Right? In the story, in the story, he talks about, I'm just gonna have to look at my notes for this one, but he talks about the divine huntress, Artemis. You know, some of you may be familiar with the story. It's quite a nice story again. And she moved in the forest with effortless ease. You know, she lived in harmony with the forest. She loved it. She honored, you know, all that came in the forest. And she was honored, you know, the people, I mean, the forest was honored to be hunted by her. That was that level of respect and understanding of nature and life and pure love, let's put it that way. And then Hercules, the son of Zeus, he was ordered to kill a magical deer. And also in his story, he wanted to gain popularity and he wanted to gain his father's approval and da, da, da. So he was ordered to kill this magical deer in the forest. And Hercules helped him and gave him these wings for speed. Anyway, it's a myth, but it's a lovely myth. Now, Artemis is this divine huntress. So she wanted Hercules, which was this wings for speed, because Hercules was getting faster and he was getting, he was able to hunt better, right? So now Artemis got herself into competitive mode, right? Because before she was like living cool in the forest and now she was getting herself competitive. He got, so I won. Then she started getting obsessed about it. And what happened was that her intention, her vibe changed and the forest felt it, because now she was moving from her ego self and she was out of harmony with the forest. So this Hercules, who was ordered to kill the deer, and Artemis, they started hanging out together and comparing hunting stories and, you know, and sort of appreciating each other as hunters. And what happened was, when he left the forest, Artemis, she started feeling sad. She was like, she was suffering when he left. And Hercules, this guy who just popped into the forest, did his thing and left, well, he had no idea what was going on. What was happening was Artemis was changing. And she started like really working on her hunt game, but from an ego perspective, right? And Hercules, Hermes is the one that gave Hercules these wings for speed so that he could be a better hunter. Well, Hermes, what happened was he took on an animal form. And so Artemis, the huntress, she was about to kill him. And just as she was about to kill him, he changed and he showed her that he was Hermes. And so she was like, I almost killed you. And he said, yes, because you're so obsessed and so absorbed in your own little story, you're so involved with this Hercules story that you and him are in competition and you get sad when he leaves. And so I put myself in an animal form to show you that you've lost touch with the forest, you've lost touch with your surroundings, and you've forgotten who you are. And she said, oh, please forgive me. She remembered who she was. And this is the story that in this game of I'm searching, I'm looking, I'm wanting, I'm hunting, that's what we are with love. We move out there with, all our knowledge and all our spears and all our, we're going to hunt it down and we're going to look for it and we're going to work on the law of attraction. But, you know, there's this hunting us, you know, like build up enough, get enough, information, read enough books, you know, equip myself. And we get obsessed with the story, right? And then we lose ourselves in the story. You're just supposed to ease into it, right? That's the story. Ease into it. Let the flow happen. And what happens is we get stuck along the way. And essentially we forget who we are. And then what happens is, it's like this thing, it traps our attention and we then become hunted, right? We then forget ourselves and we then become hunted, and we are so distracted. We move into distracted, not from everything else out there, but distracted from ourselves. And so this hunting for happiness, it's less of a hunt, really. That's what it is. And it's less of a hunt and it's more of an internal nourishment. It's less out there looking for food and looking for game, and it's more internal. Okay. So in the story of this competition is that we start this little war. He's better, I need to be better, she, oh, me, I, you know. We start this competition. And this is part of, remember what I said before? We start this internal war within ourselves. So it's how what happens is we need to focus ourselves more on ourselves, right? Because otherwise we'll find that we are trapping ourselves into our own heart space that we should be creating and building. And so what happens is we're squeezing ourselves, you know, that focus, we're squeezing ourselves into something that should be expanding. Does that make sense? It's seeing things with the eyes of love, because it's not our eyes, is the windows, as we've read before, is the windows into the world. But these eyes in the scientific, chemical, cellular level, right? It connects us to, on a very cellular level, to all of us inside, with the whole body point. So every cell in us is responding to our perception that we put out there with our eyes. And so it's about seeing with the eyes of love. And that makes a difference, because it's about getting our intention right. Yinka, what were you saying? Sorry.
I didn't say anything.
Okay, so all of this again in this divine huntress is, she lost her own power, she gave her power away, and it's about controlling our own beliefs so that we can control our own dream. Say control, maybe a different word, but it's about staying empowered, not giving our power away. It's about staying in our magic, not giving our magic away. It is here. It's a very different story about sharing. Sharing is when you're doing it with love, when you're doing it with the eyes of love, when you're doing it with the hands and the, you know, the mouth and the, you know, everything of love. Your whole being is with love. That's a different sharing process. But when you do it with another, when something moves away from you in a different, then you're giving it away, which is a very different thing, right? Something that needs to be shared. And you're giving away your good stuff, in a sense, but at the expense of yourself. You have to think about that, right? Because I can only give what I have. So if I insist on, giving away my power, giving away my voice, giving away my being, giving away my essence. It's my energy. So I need to really be considerate and conscious as to what spaces am I doing that for? What is my intention? What, you know, to who is it on the receiving end? Who is the receiving party, in the sense of, am I giving my quality, right? This giving and receiving thing. Am I giving me abundantly, or am I giving it from a point of lack? So in other words, I'm giving, but I really don't want to give. Do you understand the difference? We have to move from a space of abundance, because then it becomes sharing, and it doesn't feel that I can move from my wounded self. Then I say, poor me, I had to do this, and I gave them, and I gave them a house to live in, and I gave them food, and I gave them. Can you see the difference in that? So you're giving from a point of, right, I'm giving and I'm not getting. And that's very different from I'm giving from pure love without any contract. So healing the emotional body is all about your truth. It's all about knowing yourself. It's all about, as we just read in the Artemis story, it's about remembering yourself. It's about remembering your harmonious self and practicing that and seeing things as they are. The world right now, my God, second by second is changing. So it is absolutely lit. And now when it's on fire, or it's lit the way, what kind of light do I want to bring to the party, right? Because it's constantly adapting and changing. It's not that it happened over there in another country. It happened in that family. Everything is connected. Essentially, it will affect us at some point, as we spoke about the karmic balance. And so we need to move ourselves into, out there, the world is dynamic, it's changing. And how am I changing so that I can put out more quality? Truth, these are big words that he brings out in the book. Truth, forgiveness, and self-love. The hell and the heaven that you are creating is happening within you right now. It depends on what eyes do you see it with, right? And when you are being, I'm saying it again, there's no effort, there's no hard work. You're just being yourself. And it's with complete acceptance, right? Without but, if, however, right? Without shoulds. There's a surrender to it. There's an acceptance. There's a no resistance. There's a flow. There's an allowing. See, it's allowing myself. And then when someone else comes with their stuff, I can just allow them. Just let them be their circus that they want to be. And then they're going to move off, right? I don't need to respond to it. Or I can choose what words I want, how I want to respond to it. Down there is your choice. But it's allowing the world to also be the way it is. And it's fearless. And it's basically all it is at this point is that, listen, what we said in this whole book, we said, listen, how are we going to lighten up? How are we going to make this more fun, right? Out there is a drunk, chaotic mess. How are we going to sew up our own story, right? So that we can allow the flow, allow the drinking to happen regardless. But we need to sober up. We need to gain clarity. We need to start thinking, you know, what's the stuff that whets my appetite, that gets me moving, that gets me excited? That's all it is, really. So the whole book, which is very nice and lovely and sweet and simple, is about self-love. Shall we take a moment, Yinka? You're mute.
Do you want to share this or?
Yeah.
I'm going to stop sharing the screen so we can do it as one.
Yeah, so screen's open.
So people are willing?
Yeah.
You can put your cameras on so we can do this as one.
Perfect.
And connect.
So as some of you know, the throat chakra here, the throat area, is about expression. It's about voice. It's about identity. It's about what we give out to the world, right? So this is this area here. And it does not have to come out in words. It can come out in art, in creativity, in colors, in any form of the way you want to be artistic about it. So generally, this is the area. If you go to this area, what we're going to do is just gently tap around this area, around the throat area. That's it. Around the throat area. And just start thinking about the softness of our words that we want to put out. Just start thinking about the creative ways that we want to now express ourselves. Start thinking about the more colorful beings that we want to be. Gentle taps around the throat. And then we'll move it further down onto the breastbone. And you're always going to be like tapping it a little harder, as if you're beating yourself like a drum beat to say, right, waken up now, okay, to this new beginning. this new dream, this new experience, just, you know, on the like the breastbone, right? And we move ourselves now into taking it from the breastbone and expanding it out like the wings, right? Just expand it out as if your shoulder blades are going to be touching at the back, as broad and bold as an eagle. And you, in this, we're breathing in this freedom of being ourselves, permission to be me. Right, just stay there for a second. Right, breathe in the new you. Almost like you're hugging yourselves. Breathe in, pull your arms together, hugging yourselves. And then breathe out this new you. There we go. Again, arms spread. And we do that 3 times. And breathe in this new you. And breathe out the freedom of being just as you are, acceptance. And breathe in this new you. There we go. Right, just hug yourselves for a second. So, Yinka, do we have time for breakout rooms, just for everyone to have a discussion about?
Well, we'll just do it. And those that want to join a breakout room can, and those that don't, you can just stay on the screen.
Okay.
So, do you want to say that bit first?
Yeah, well, I've said it in the talk, and now what it is like when you're reading the book, you're reading words, are you not? Right? You're reading words that's gonna change your concept, change your, and so now moving from the book into the world is just saying, right, I'm now going to read the world in a different way. I'm going to reread it. I'm going to refresh my views, right? I'm going to readjust. I'm going to realign. And it's just all with a softer tone of love. Seeing the world through the eyes of love. Okay, shall we move into breakout rooms?
Yeah, so in the breakout room, I will share this in the breakout room as well, so you can still see it there. So share, how do you now see yourself as the master of your own story? How do you plan to play out your next chapter? So I will put this screen on in the breakout room as well.
Perfect.
If you don't want to go in a breakout room, if you don't want to share, please don't click on it, because I won't know that you're not sharing in a breakout room. And if there's no one in your breakout room, just wait there, I will, because I know some of you might not want to go in a breakout room. I will put you in a different one. There you go. So I just, this is the last part. So I want to give a big thank you to Shams for coming to do the session. And this is the first time. So if you think she's done a good job and you've been able to take something from it, you know, put a heart or whatever in the chat. And I've been trying to convince Shams to come and do these more often. So if you'd like to see her again as well, put in the chat, you'd like to see her again.
Bless you all. Thank you. I've enjoyed the session myself. I've also enjoyed the book, reading the book. If you haven't read it, it's quite an easy read. It's a lovely energy as well, sharing. As you know, we can sometimes take a line that's a sits with us and we can open it and expand it, you know, into so many different directions. There's so much to be said. So thank you so much for sharing the platform today, and hopefully we'll do some more. Thank you absolutely to my fellow hair raiser, Yinka.
Yes.
It's been lovely.
Awesome. Yeah. And I'm just going to leave a song playing. One day Sol will come and sing for us, sing us out. We'll have Renisha on to come and do a session, so we'll come and sing for us. Of the whole tribe, come and create your pieces of art. So I'm going to put the focus mode on for this bit, so you just listen to the words of the song. I'm going to mute as well.
I was searching, I was looking for meaning. I was wondering, desperately trying only. I have nothing missing. Who said I have to find who I am? Who said that I am lost to begin with? I am already enough. Everything I need is within me. Each morning. My motivation can't be validation. I'd always be starving for more affection, the wrong attention, only to feel like I am nothing. Who said I have to find who I am? Who said that I am lost to begin? I was searching, I was looking for meaning. I was wondering, desperately trying, only to see I have nothing missing. Who said I have to find who I am? Who said that I am lost to begin?
Thanks, everyone. See you all soon.